Did you know that it's still legal to enter into a flying armbar in judo? It's legal if the opponent is in newaza, or as they transition from newaza into tachiwaza. So in this video, I'm going to be looking at lots of legal and illegal judo techniques. We're going to look at joint locks, chokes, and lots of leg grabs and leg grab legal variations that you might not know. Let's look at an example of an illegal joint lock. This is Yuusei Ogawa, son of Naoya Ogawa, and he's going to take his opponent's wrist and drive it up his back towards his shoulder. And this is an illegal technique because it's a direct attack on the shoulder. In judo, you're allowed to do joint locks against the elbow. You cannot directly attack the shoulder like Yuusei Ogawa did. Now let's look at a legal joint lock. This is Te-gatame by Momo Tamaoki. And notice that when she gets her opponent's wrist up against her back, she pulls the forearm away from the back towards the elbow. So the pressure from the lock is moving towards the elbow, not up the back towards the shoulder like in the illegal technique. Now I'll give you the chance to play IJF video referee so you can decide whether you think this should be Ippon or Hansoku-make. So Chizuru Arai in the blue judo gi up against a very flexible opponent from Russia, Taimazova. Now Taimazova, rather than trying to escape the position, is simply trying to use her flexibility. So let's see how flexible that arm is. First she's got to bend the arm. Then she can attack it. So the referee called for a video review after Taimazova protested that the lock was illegal. However, the video referee decided that the match should continue. So here is another look at a potentially illegal lock. So Momo Tamaoki forcing a turnover by putting pressure on the joint as soon as Osai Komi's called. Her opponent submits, and her opponent is very, very unhappy indeed with the way this match turned out. She protests the decision. Here's a look again. Tamaoki turning the arm as she gets the turnover, then releases the arm and moves into a hold down. So the blue girl, the Italian girl, certainly feels quite upset at the moment and protesting strongly. She thinks it should have been ruled Hansoku-make. It was ruled Ippon. What do you think? Let me know in the comments. Now we'll have a look at one of judo's most dangerous throws. So throwing when you're using the opponent's sleeves stops them from being able to defend the takedown. And these examples are completely legal. That's Hifumi Abe knocking out his opponent with an osode-gari from double sleeve control. Monster Takeshi Sasaki is dumped on his head by a real monster and ends up in semi-consciousness. Another chance for you to play IJF video referee. So you see a one-handed sode attempt from Momo Tamaoki against Jessica Klimkate. And clearly this is an attack on the joint. One-handed sode is a lot more dangerous than two-handed sode grip. But when you have the second sleeve grip, it pulls the opponent's body towards you. So in this match, Tamaoki was disqualified Hansoku-make. Here's another opportunity for you to play video ref. We're going to see two attempts at sode from Tsukasa Yoshida against the seat. The referee halts the match because he wants the video referee to step in and decide whether Yoshida should be disqualified for these sode throws. What do you think? So, video ref ruled that these were legal throws and the match was continued. And The thing that bugs me about this particular case is the referee called mate just as it looked like Yoshida was entering into ude-garami. Yoshida's pretty strong with this technique. It's almost a cliche in judo to see the Japanese women put the French women away using ude-garami. Next, we'll have a look at what technique Tamaoki likes to do when the sode fails. This is a leg grab legal version of sukui-nage. So she maintains control of the sleeve, pulls the opponent's arm between the legs, and throws them. Here's a classical version of sukui-nage. Here's a 2017 version of sukui-nage. This is now illegal. Nagase is using the opponent's lapel ends to pull them up from the hips and then wheelbarrowing them around. Here's another example of a sukui-nage performed like this by Momo Tamaoki. That scored a waza-ari. And here's a very big version of this type of sukui-nage that was performed, I believe it's a Wassingberger from Austria at the Portugal Grand Prix this year. Now we'll have a look at another situation. So we've got Momo Tamaoki in the white judo gi. Let's see if you spot something illegal. Did you see something illegal happen there? So if you did, then you could get a job as an IJF video ref, because the video ref for this particular match did not pick it up, and Momo Tamaoki went on to win by a choke. Here's the illegal act. There it is, the leg grab. Perhaps the last time a leg grab will ever lead to an Ippon in IJF judo. And Tamaoki, clearly very guilty. Look at the expression on her face. The coach is like, quick, you've got the car waiting outside, the engine's running. Let's get in and get out of here before they realize what we've done. Now we're going to have a look at a rule called the stretched leg rule. Sometimes you see a player going for a choke and the referee stopping the match because of the stretched leg rule. Okay, so in this sequence, Tamaoki goes through a few different choke attempts. Now she's trying to do a variation of sankaku jime, but the opponent's blocking her legs. So Tamaoki is going to come up and switch into a standard okuri eri jime attempt. This one's not going to work, but she's going to try it again. And this time the opponent straightens her leg out. Tamaoki grabs onto the leg and pulls her backwards. And the referee halts the match, not because the choke was complete, not because of mate, but because of the stretched leg of the Korean player. So when you pull on an opponent's stretched leg, it can result in hamstring damage. It could cause a hamstring tear. So in judo, you get a penalty, not a disqualification, just a penalty for stretching the leg. Now, the first time I saw this, I thought it was really ridiculous, because with the stretched leg rule, many times the players are intentionally putting their leg in a stretched position in order to get a penalty call on their opponent. And then I found this clip and I was like, oh, okay, you can still pull off the choke even with the stretched leg. So notice how the girl in the blue is not pulling up on that leg. She's just keeping her weight above the leg. She's basically balancing on her own elbow and she's not pulling on that leg. She's pulling on the gi and she gets the win. The referee calls Ippon as the girl in the white begins to go limp. Not sure of the name of the girl in the blue judo gi. She's from Fukuoka University. So now we're going to look at a leg grab legal sasai-tsurikomi-ashi counter. So this is a leg grab legal variation of kuchiki taoshi or kibisu gaishi, single leg or ankle pick, as it's known in wrestling. Here's an example on the left of classical kibisu gaishi being used in the leg grab era. Another judoka who uses this is Aram Grigorian in the blue judo gi. He uses this as a counter for Kosoto Gari. You can see his opponent from Kazakhstan protesting. His coach in the background is also protesting, claiming that this is an illegal technique. In IJF rules, all Ippons must be confirmed by a video referee, so this is a legal technique. You don't see it very often, but once more people realize that this is a legal technique, you're probably going to start seeing it a lot more. Now we'll have a look at another legal leg round variation. So I'm sure you know that traditional kata guruma is illegal and a non-scoring technique. However, there is a way you can do the kata guruma. You can do it from newaza. So both girls were in newaza, and then Funa Tanaki went into the traditional leg grab variation of kata guruma, used it to set up a newaza win victory. So if you do want to bring back the leg grab legal techniques, look for them in newaza. Now let's look at wakigatame. Wakigatame is a common cause for disqualification, but it's a legal technique used in newaza. You don't see it a lot on the IJF World Tour, but Ozturk of Turkey is a big fan of this technique. She likes to do makikomi and then apply wakigatame. In English, wakigatame would be known as armpit lock. In this case, it resulted in her opponent needing a stretcher to get off the tatami. Here's another variation. Makikomi directly into wakigatame. Now here's a disqualification. Wakigatame is illegal from standing, so in this case the French judoka initially does like a one-arm ude-garami and then drops her weight into the elbow. I think it was accidental. I think she lost her balance and fell forward a little bit on the arm, and the Korean judoka in this case didn't take too much damage and she ended up with a gold medal. Here is another case of wakigatame. So the judoka in white is the same girl we saw very upset with Momo Tamaoki earlier in this video. So here she was disqualified for using a wakigatame against a Belgian judoka. I believe it's Liba of Belgium. And she's pretty confused about the referee's call. You can see she did drop her weight into the opponent's elbow for wakigatame. Here's a strange one. Wakigatame leading to a disqualification, even though she wasn't holding the arm. The opponent was holding her collar and she attempted harai makikomi. Now here's a legal wakigatame from standing. So in this case, the girl in white, Stein Hughes, was holding the Italian's sleeve. When the Italian turned in for harai makikomi, the girl in white was hanging on to that sleeve and ended up getting caught with a wakigatame, and the video ref ruled that the match should continue. Now let's look at a surprising disqualification situation. We see a sumigaishi stumble. She tries to catch her opponent with ochigari as she falls, and this match continued for a little while, and then there was a disqualification. Both judokas and coaches look very surprised, and of course the girl in blue and her coach are extremely upset about this decision. So the disqualification ruling was that she had driven her opponent into the mat. I'm not sure whether it was the first time when she popped the opponent down, or the second time when she tried to catch Charline Van Snick with ochigari as she left the guard position. So their other match got pretty weird as well. So this was not Ippon. So Van Snick did injure the elbow, but because the girl in blue, the Israeli, was able to lift her off the ground, mate was called. And then later in the match, we saw ukiwaza attempt into osai komi. And osai komi is called, And you'll see in the background that Ippon is displayed on the screen, but this match continues and we end up with two Ippons in a row. So here it is, Ippon number two. Juji-gatame again for the win. Now officially, the IJF records this as a Tate-shiho-gatame win. Now, I've shown you a few eye pokes in this video so far. Let's look at another one. That was no Shido. How about this one? What do you think? Shido, Hansoku-make, no penalty. This one resulted in Hansoku-make disqualification. Here's another one that resulted in Hansoku-make recently. Spinning strike. Now here's a legal way to throw a punch. Watch the right hand of Lucas Karpalak. He basically knocked him down with a kochigari followed by a right hand. He had a fistful of judo gi, so it's completely legal. I'll put it up in slow motion again so you can have a look at it. Here we go. Watch the right hand. Bang! Straight into the jaw. Sends the guy's head spinning. I think it's a lot more powerful than Bruce Lee's one-inch punch, which was more of a parlor trick in my mind. I hope you enjoyed this video. My goal is to have another video up on Friday of next week. See you then.